Hello and welcome to a new Forex webinar organized by ForexBot Trading Academy. Our site is forexbot.com, as you already know, and we are happy to have you here today. My name is Julian and I will be your presenter today. The webinar is presented and the information herein is given under the current disclaimer. So please take a minute and go through the disclaimer itself. The information we will provide and will discuss is not to be taken as a financial or trading advice. And it is given for education purposes only. So please take a second and get through this disclaimer. In one of our previous webinars that we held here, and maybe you attended, we've created a simple EA, expert advisor or trading robot, and we promised we will try to come to your help and assist you in getting it to trade more with the better results, and that can be achieved by different ways, in many ways, of which one of the most important is the right entry rule that fits the market conditions or the market we are trying to trade. That is why today's webinar will try to offer information about how we can code into our expert advisors not only one set of entry rules, but maybe more of them, and switching between those. So that is why the present webinar has this title, EA Trade Entry Rules, Switching Engines. Trying to code into our expert advisors multiple entry rules can come in a trader's journey as a consequence of realizing that not all markets behave the same, not all instruments behave the same, and not all hours of the day are equally profitable. Therefore, trying to hone and pinpoint when the right conditions are met, one may try to improve the entry rules. The previous expert advisor we've worked on, called Paper Plane, was, and I'm trying to remind you, was a simple expert advisor that tried to enter the market tried to trade directionally, listening and taking its entry signal from moving average, more precisely a sloping moving average. In our example, it was a 20 periods simple moving average of the close price. On that idea, today we will try to add to our new expert advisor, we will try to code another entry that will be used in conjunction with the first entry rule, or it can be used separately. Hence, the one of the benefits we've enumerated here. So, having multiple entries in an expert advisor will allow us to trade different market types, and I'm referring here to markets that have the underlying asset in different asset classes, not only forex or commodities or energy or such things. And as we know, or we will learn in due time, different markets behave differently. Another benefit of having multiple entries or entry rules or entry strategies inside the same expert advisor is that it will allow us to identify different market conditions, because as we know, again, markets tend to behave differently at different hours of the day. Even the same market has a period of consolidation, a period of impulsive move, a trending period, and these characteristics more or less qualify practically most of the markets we are trying to trade. For example, in a highly correlated currency pair like Aussie Kiwi, there are many examples when the market is in prolonged periods of consolidation. And in this particular type of market, on this particular currency pair, trending expert advisor will have a hard time getting profitable. Conversely, in a market that tends to behave differently and be more trendy or stay in moving trends for longer periods of time, trend following expert advisor will have better chances at obtaining positive results. Therefore, identifying different market conditions can be something not useful but necessary to implement in our expert advisors. Another benefit I thought was worth mentioning is having multiple strategies in our expert advisors will allow us to test multiple strategies or combinations of strategies, and we know that, for example, a currency pair that tends to stay in trends for prolonged periods of time can be traded successfully using a trend following system, for example, but using maybe a different filter or criteria for the entry rule. In this example, a 20 period simple moving average on H1 chart in dollar yen is not something that will produce many clear signals, and experimenting with different periods or let's say moving average lengths may prove to be or to produce better results over time. Here, for example, a 20 moving average, that is the thin moving average on the chart compared to a 100 moving average or even a 200 moving average on the same chart on the same period can result in taking multiple signals, not having to deal with the natural oscillations in that specific market. And if we were, for example, in this move, to listen only to the 20 period moving average, we could have entered the sell here for a short period of time and eventually get taken out here and here and here, and why not even getting suckered or faked out in a long position here. But when we are looking at the bigger picture, for example, and we are filtering the signals given by the 20 simple moving average with the longer period moving average, like it is the 100, for example, or the 200 moving average, 200 periods moving average, then we would have either stayed longer in some trades or captured maybe bigger moves in that particular market. So this being the benefits, let's say what could go wrong when we implement multiple entry rules or sets of entry rules in the same expert advisor. A trap that can work against us can be the fact that multiple strategies implemented in the same expert advisor can result in signals that contradict each other. The signals in an expert advisor, if they don't speak the same language or show the same picture, and there are not, let's say, in tune with what happens in the market, then it can result in a performance that is not as we expect. And we can take a look, for example, if we were to have in an expert advisor, let's say, taking as example the paper plane first version of EA that was looking at the 20 period simple moving average, and we were to implement, for example, along this trend following simple entry rule, if we were to implement another entry rule that is trying to offer us, or we may want to use that other rule to pinpoint entries, we may end up, for example, with a trend following signal, and that is trying to keep us on the right side of the trade, and the secondary rule may put us in trades that have little chances of success of getting profitable. For example, if we were to marry trend following moving average slope type entry rule that we've discussed previously with a mean reversion based on Bollinger Bands, in this case both having the same 20 periods moving average as a reference signal, We see that, for example, there are some cases when both signals can tell us the same story and put us in profitable trades, but there are also times when the signals contradict each other. Let's look for such signals. For example, in a mean reversion trading strategy, the assumption is that the price stays inside the Bollinger Bands for most of the time, and statistically it is proven that over 95% of the time the price tends to stay within the two standard deviation of the Bollinger Bands, the upper and the lower band. And for example here, whenever the price reaches outside the Bollinger Bands, it tends to reverse, reaches outside and then reverses, reaches outside and then reverses, and so on and so forth. And if we are trying to trade, for example, this prolonged period of time when the price was mostly in an upward direction, evolved mostly in an upward direction, then we may end up looking for buy signals over the moving average, when the price is over the moving average, and look for sell signals when the price is above the upper Bollinger Band, like it is here and here and here and here. What that will result in a long long signal, in a buy signal given by the moving average slope, and in a sell signal given by the fact that the price reached outside the Bollinger Bands and closed eventually back in, waiting for a reversal. So this is how two types of entries can contradict each other. And if we are trying to implement a solution or a set or a multiple of sets of rules for entries, we must pay attention whether the signals that are generated using both or all the sets of rules contradict each other or not. So another pitfall many expert advisor developers fall in is implementing in their expert advisors so many rules that the probability of them being at the same time or in a short period, short succession of time, being consequent and not contradicting each other, practically looking for very rare events. So the probability is very, very small, so small that we may have very few entries, and those that qualify as valid entries may end up being just signals generated by chance and not because there is something to trade in there. A popular, relatively popular way of trading mean reversion strategy, for example, is that in which we are looking for a period of imbalance, and I will take as an example the same chart we've looked at earlier, and maybe a period that is close enough, and see if, for example, in a trend following strategy, we are looking to buy over the moving average. If the price goes above it, we buy. If the price goes below, we sell. The previous version of the paper plane implemented a signal based on the slope of the moving average. So if the slope was up and the price was above that moving average, then we were looking to buy. If the price was below the moving average and the slope was down, as it is, for example, in this case, the moving average is moving downwards and the price is below, then we were looking to sell. So in this case, if we were to trade this particular portion of the chart, we may want to look for signals that point in the same direction. And that can be a very rare thing if we are looking, for example, to trade mean reversion strategy at the same time as a trend following strategy. How would that rare condition look like? For example, let's say that in this zone of the chart, the moving average is moving upwards, the slope is still upwards, but the price reached below the lower Bollinger band. That would be, from the perspective of the mean reversion strategy, an opportunity to buy. And if the slope of the moving average would also point up, it would be an opportunity to buy. But as we see, if the moving average is short enough, it doesn't maintain the upward slope in this case, even if the price drops below it, which is outside the Bollinger band, it still responded pretty quickly to the price evolution and begin to drop too. So in this case, the rare event when the price signals when the Bollinger band signals an imbalance in price in the market and the moving average still points in the same direction, then we would enter long. But that rare event is not happening, not here, and here neither. Because by the time we have a signal, either the moving average adapted to the recent price evolution or the imbalance in the market is no longer there and the market already rebalanced itself. So looking for rare events like that. Here another one. Moving average moving up. Imbalance, we want to sell, but if we are to look at the moving average, we would be inclined to buy. So these two signals contradict each other, and again, the rare event when the slope is down and the imbalance in the market, let's say, would occur here, then it would be an opportunity to sell and maybe get in the next leg down. Well, that is why it's important to acknowledge if we are trying to look for something that happens often enough to give enough signals to declare ourselves satisfied with the frequency of the signals and the quality of them, or if we are trying to code and look for things that happen once in a blue moon. And this being the two main cons of, let's say, implementing multiple entry rules in the same expert advisor, let's see how we can further narrow our search and pick the right indicators, if we choose to use indicators to base our signals on, how we can try and narrow the search I was saying and pick the right tools for the job. For example, in our previous iteration of the paper plane expert advisor, we were planning to achieve and to code and to exploit trend following system. Therefore, if the main idea behind the expert advisor and how it should work is trend following, then maybe we must choose indicators that, as we've seen before, don't contradict each other. They offer consistent and consequent signals, and they speak the same language, giving us a clear enough picture about what is happening in that market. And let's take a look at what indicators we may want to select or to choose from when we are trying to marry them together. As we've already seen, a moving average based trade entry rule and a volatility signaling mean reversion by design type of entry rule based on Bollinger Bands don't work that well together, because they are telling us two different stories about the same market, and whether we are trying to look for rare events or we get contradicting signals is not good either way. Therefore, a trend following strategy should employ indicators that deal with the trend. And even if the Bollinger Band is classified as a trend indicator, we know that oftentimes it is not used as such. We may use the Bollinger Band itself as a trend following in a trend following strategy or expert advisor to base our signals on, but that would have to take into consideration other criteria than the ones we've discussed earlier. For example, Bollinger Bands used in a trend following trading system should take into consideration whether the central line of the Bollinger Bands, which is a simple moving average of a certain period, is pointing in a certain direction, whether the price hugged that central line for the however many bars we are trying to look back, and see that the continuous chase in between the price and the moving average is pointing rather towards a consolidating market like it is here, or a trending market. Which is which, and how can we discern in between them? One way, relatively simple to implement, is by looking whether the price touched the moving average we are referencing. The moving average we take as a reference. So let's look at whether the price, once it began to move in a certain direction, took time or moved in such a manner that the moving average had time to catch up with it. Because it's a common misconception that price reacts to the moving average. The price itself has better things to do. The price just eats orders wherever it can find them. What the price does near the moving averages is practically the graphical representation of what traders are doing at those specific levels. The price couldn't care less about the moving average. What we are seeing is whatever the reaction of the traders was in that market around that specific level. And in this case, as we see, the continuous chase in between the price and the moving average results in periods when the price moves so drastically and so decisively in one direction as it rarely, if ever, touches the moving average we are looking at. Or in the market may evolve into a pattern in which the moving average has enough time to catch up with the price, because by the time the moving average visits or gets into the range of the price is already in that range for a significant period of time, like we see here in this market, or here, a period of consolidation after an impulsive move up that was followed eventually by a drop in price, and the price moved in such a manner that the moving average had time to catch up with the price here and here and here and so on and so forth. So getting back to what indicators are fit for the purpose we are planning, let's look at indicators that may help us. In this case, let's say that if trend is something we want to trade, then something about trend must also gather as information. We must also gather information about the trend, either his strength, its strength, or things of that nature. For example, we may look at a parabolic stop and reverse indicator. We may look at envelopes. We may look at other different things, but usually implementing in an expert advisor indicators that take their values or derive their values in similar enough manners results in indeed in two or more indicators telling the same story about the same event in the market, but using slightly different words, which is again not very useful, because if we already know the trend is down and that is obvious, we don't need the three indicators that tell us the same story with slight variations. Therefore, let's try to expand our search into the oscillators category, and that can have multiple benefits, as we will see. For example, one of the most used and very known indicators is the relative strength index. As its name suggests, this momentum indicator, for example, can help us pinpoint zones in the market where the price is more likely to evolve in a somewhat predictable manner. We know that this bounded indicator oscillates in between 0 and 100, and it has at least two levels that many traders watch, and the notions they use are overbought and oversold. when the indicators value go over and under those 30 and 70 levels. Therefore, let's see how our trend following strategy can use the relative strength index, which should allow us to see when there is strength behind a certain move in the price evolution. And as we see, even if the moving average is sloping down, when the price moves in a decisive manner to the downside, it eventually reaches a point when many traders at least stop selling, if not they start buying. And this oversold area, for example, is the moment when the price can begin to look again up and move upwards. And if we couple these inflection points with what information we can gather from the other entries, rules, having a rule based on a relative strength index can help us in finding markets or periods in price evolution when there is more likely for a certain outcome to take place. And for example, if we were to trade the relative strength index as most traders do all by itself, then the overbought and oversold areas would have to be points where we are trying to pick tops and bottoms, which is not a very, it is a very popular idea, but it's not a very wise one, because as we see, for example, here, an oversold condition doesn't result necessarily in the market not going down anymore. And after a short period of rebound, eventually the price reaches even more down, even lower levels. So we must take the relative strength index as the indicator that it is. It is showing strength behind a certain move, and we are trying to use its indication as an indicator that indicates strength. So if we have bearish, and this is an extreme move, so maybe it's not the best example, but if we have an inclination and a bias to sell this market, if the RSI also points to the downside, then maybe it's a better idea than to try to pick this bottom or even this bottom, because whichever zone we've picked, we are proven wrong here and here and here, and the market then goes into a sideways move and consolidates after such a sudden drop. So picking the bottom here, here and here may eventually result in an average position that is somewhere around here and eventually closes. But is that the best use of our time, funds and risk? We'll see. So coming back, if the relative strength index is our weapon of choice, we are trying to look at what it indicates. It indicates strength, and we want it to indicate strength in the market in the same direction we already established the trend is more likely to continue. And let's look at some other example. We have price above the moving average and we are looking for buys, which would be good opportunities to buy this market and where. Maybe as long as the RSI doesn't go overbought and as long as the RSI is pointing upwards, maybe we would want to be in that move. Why? Because there is strength in that market and the strength is going up. Here, sudden drop, moving average down, relative strength not oversold yet. So in between this point, there is some pips to be gained. If we are not trying to pick tops or bottoms, but we are looking at the market and trying to listen to what it has to say. And if we are to narrow our search and find few suitable candidates for what our purpose is, that of finding signals, that of finding good signals, reliable signals, so many signals as we want, so often as we choose, and we are basing our decisions upon a handful of indicators. Each of them can be coded into a specific entry rule, and we can use those entry rules separately, which will allow us to switch any one of them or any combination we may choose. For example, in the previous version of the expert advisor we've coded together, we've listened only to the moving average slope. If we choose the RSI also as a suitable indicator, and we decide that we could use that, once we have a rule that is giving signals based on the moving average slope and another rule that is giving signals based on the RSI slope, for example, then having either one of them active or both of them active at the same time will result in different performance. Let's see if having two strategies working together would improve our entry, for example. And trying to gauge that, let's look at this portion of the chart. Trend following, moving under the moving average, slope is down. If we were to use only the slope, we would enter here. Entering here and looking only at the moving average, that would be a valid entry. And any other candle that is below the moving average would also be a valid entry. But now let's look at the RSI. For example, this entry, we have the RSI pointing down and then getting in this period of the market, it would have kept out us out of this at least 3-4 occasions where the market moved in a sideways pattern. And if we were to look only at the moving average, we would have tried to enter here and here and here and here. But if we were to look also at the RSI, we see that it is not sloping downwards anymore, and maybe it is slightly upwards sloping. And then again, we have a green go signal on this candle because it is sloping down. Then again, sideways, then down, sideways, down, eventually upwards. This would not be a good buy opportunity, as we see. If we are looking also at the RSI, this will also not be good buys opportunities, even if the price is still below the moving average. Why? Because the strength in the market is not pointing down anymore. We have the indicator that tells us that the strength is not on the bear's side anymore. Here, 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 and here. No matter if the price is still under the moving average. And in this case, if we were to trade only the moving average, we would have some entries, all of them valid based on that set of rules. If we were to have a different strategy based only on the RSI, we would have different entries, each and every one of them valid based on this set of rules. But if we were to have two different strategies, one based on moving average and the other one based on RSI, we would have definitely another type of entries and at different points in time, filtering out maybe the bad trades, spacing out the good trades, and why not eventually getting more profitable than in the case when we would have only one of them. And that is why it is useful to implement in our expert advisors code portions or let's say strategies that are coded in such a way that they can be switched on and off, and we can experiment with every combination we want. How that will look, we'll see in a short while. Before that, we will also, after we will write the code, we will also have to look and verify that the signals that are given are valid under the set of rules we've chosen to activate, to keep active, and to look at. And any combination possible is also producing good enough results, or at least under the sets of rules implemented, valid entries. And now let's, if we are already spoken about the previous version, I will try to refresh your memory and we'll take a look at the paper plane expert advisor we've worked on previously. As we mentioned before, this one had as an entry validation the moving average slope, which was taken as a signals the slope of a specific moving average of which parameters were coded here and exposed to the user, and the user could set the period shift type of moving average and the price used. What that signal generating part of the code looked like, it was something like this. The code had a function called getSignal, and in that function we've coded as a solution in this manner the string called moving average slope signal was given a default value of weight, and if the strategy was active, then we would get two values for the moving average from one bar ago and from the moving average two bars back. And if the price was bigger than the last bars moving average, and the previous bars were smaller than the previous bar, then we would have valid buy signal, conversely on the sell side. Now, as we've already hinted, when we were coding this solution, we could have, as we see here, this commented line. We already thought of a use case when the entry validation section of the expert advisor could allow us to have not one but two, and not two but many other entry rules. And for that, at that particular time, we've called that RSI OBOS, which would mean RSI were bought oversold, for example, and we've already included there, but left it commented for further development, future development. Now, let's take that uncommented, and we'll use as a as planned as the basis of the secondary signal, the other strategy entry signal, the RSI. For that, we would need, as we've already used for the moving average type entry signal, some moving average settings. We will also need a specific set of settings for the RSI. And I'll try to bring in a portion of the code that is already written, and we'll make that look like so. So now in our expert advisor, we have another section called RSI settings, which will allow us to set the RSI period, the price for which the RSI is calculated, in this case, the close price as default, and the minimum RSI and maximum RSI values, which will be taken into consideration when we will be trying to filter all our signals. Then, moving, we'll try to modify, because in the onTick function, which is run on every tick, we have a on every bar, we run these two lines. The first line gets the signal calling the getSignal function. The other line uses the signal generating the trade. So for this line, we would have a valid signal taken from this function called getSignal. And in the getSignal function, which now looks like this, we will have to add the case we've talked about. And for that, as is the case when the MA slope is active, is set to true, then these lines are executed and a signal is given, and that signal is verified here, and the operation is set as a buy or as a sell and returned to be used on the onTick function. Now we'll put in another part of code that will generate in the similar manner the signals we need based on the RSI values. And this looks like this, and I'll explain what that means. We create a string called RSI OBOS signal. We assign it a value as default, a value of weight. And if the strategy is activated in the user's EA's parameter settings, then we execute these three lines of code. We define an RSI a variable that holds the RSI value 2 bars back, and a variable that holds the RSI value 1 bars back, and then we verify whether the RSI values from 2 bars back and from the two and from 1 bar back are looking downwards or upwards, and at the same time, if the last bar's value for the RSI is bigger than the minimum RSI level we've also set before, then we have an up direction, and that will be used as a signal given by this strategy. Why we are using the minimum level and the maximum level, 30 and 70, in a different way than overbought and oversold? Because we are looking to buy when there is strength on the upside, but we are not buying when the market is oversold. We are looking to sell when the RSI is looking downward, but we are not looking to sell if the market is overbought. We are waiting for the market to come and the RSI to get into the tradable zone in between 30 and 70, and we are not putting neither a limit to the value of the RSI could have, because a market can get oversold and remain oversold for a period of time, and that may still result in profitable trades. But once this market gets oversold at this point, no matter if the RSI is still looking downwards, we are not selling anymore. Nor here, nor here, nor here. Just because the RSI is telling us that there is more likely, the more likely scenario is that this market will not go much farther down. And that is, we are choosing to stop selling at that point. And we are buying when the RSI is beyond the minimum level, is looking upwards and is above the minimum level. And this is what this part of the code and verification does. If the RSI from the 1 bar back is above the minimum level, or it is below the maximum level, then we have an up or down direction. And now let's see if having not one, but two, can result in valid trades, and how can we generate those valid trades. As we see here, as we've done with the moving average values, we've coded a separate function to which we were feeding only the shift value, my MA1, meaning give me the value for the shift 1 moving average, and my MA2 is give me the value for the 2 bars back moving average. And that is done using this function, in which we've coded as an entry parameter shift, and we've used the included the function IMA, which calculates and gives back the value of the moving average for the specified shift period. And in a similar manner, we'll code the RSI function that will also return the values we need when we are assigning to this variable this value, and to this variable the value returned by the function in this case. And the RSI is MRSI, or my RSI, for the specified shift. I'm using IRSI symbol, period, RSI period, and RSI price for the shift values. And now we have a valid RSI OBOS signal, which can be either wait, up, or down. Now, in the previous version, we've only had one type of entry. We've only had MA slope and its signal. And when that signal was up, we were buying. When that MA slope signal was down, we were selling. Now, how can we make that this part of the code works with one strategy, the other strategy, or both at the same time? We would have to reconfigure this part of the code, and modifying it will allow us to have either one of them active or both of them active at the same time, or none of them active at the same time, which will result in no signals at all. And these two lines will get replaced by a couple of other lines I've written already, and I will bring in. I will let them, these old ones, in place to look at them and see which are the differences. Now, this specific part of the getSignal function, which deals with interpreting MA slope signal and RSI or BOS signal, depending whether the MA slope is active or the RSI is active, or both of them are active at the same time, we'll have to take these signals and produce a valid operation, which is a op buy or an op sell. How does it do that? And we have two strategies, two lines. What happens here? If the MA slope signal is up, or the MA slope is disabled, then this is true. So we have this part true, whether the signal is up or the strategy is disabled. And the second part is dealing in a similar manner with the second strategy. So this part is also true if either the signal is up or the strategy is disabled. And when we have this true and this true both at the same time, then we have an operation of this type, operation buy. In a similar manner, this becomes true when either the signal is down or the strategy is disabled. And this becomes true when either the signal is down or the strategy is disabled. And two statements being true result in a true condition that will put the operation in this state and will generate the valid signal. Now, this happens when either one of the strategies are true, or both of the strategies are true, activated. But what happens when none of the strategies are activated? For that case, we are putting yet another line in here, and this line will take care of that situation when none of the above statements are true, and both of the signals can stay disabled and still result in a valid value for the getSignal operation, that in this case is the default value of -1, which is neither an op buy nor an op sell. So the function will still produce an answer but the answer will not be actionable, will not be tradable, because there is no such thing as a minus one operation. An op buy is a zero, an op sell is a one, but a minus one doesn't exist. And that being in place, we'll do another small alteration to the previously written code, and then we can move to testing. The other small alteration that needed to be done is changing this line. And I'm leaving also in place to see the modifications. That line was showing us some values on the chart without having to look at the graph, and so on and so forth. The previous version was displaying the account balance, the account equity, and the account free margin, but it was displaying them as numbers as they were in the platform itself and with many decimals, which resulted in an unpleasant look. In the new line, we've just converted this double to a string, and we've specified a certain precision. In this case, a precision of 2, which means that the account balance, however big or small that is, will practically be displayed as a string with only 2 decimals. And the same for account equity and for account free margin. Now, if all is in place and working, compiling the code. So, recap, a small recap, what we've done, we put another entry validation strategy. Previously, we only had an A slope. Now we have an RSI slope also, which results in us having a signal based either on MA slope or on RSI OBOS strategy. In one of them true, or none of them true, or both of them true. All cases will result in an operation and then entry. Now let's see if that works. We'll save this as a paper plane version 2 and compile it, and then we'll try to test it. Now, what are we testing on? Strategy tester. We are looking for the paper plane version 2. And let's see how the settings look like now. The settings for the strategy, I guess I'm having them on another screen. I'm trying to bring them on the current screen to be able to modify them. Okay, that's not it. I'm not seeing them. I'm hearing them, but I'm not seeing them. This is a tricky thing to do. Let's see. Let's try to restart the platform, and maybe that will solve the issue, because we will have to use the settings to verify whether one of the strategies is active, the other one is active, or both of them are active. And without being able to do that, we'll not have how to test. Now I'm restarting the trading platform, and that should put us into working order if all goes as planned. Welcome back. Strategy tester. We're trying to see the expert properties, which for some reason don't want to show. And I only have this many screens. And all the screens I have don't help me see the properties of the expert advisor, which is something we cannot have. I ask for your patience a little bit more to see whether I can convince this finicky platform to behave, and let us test what we've done by now. We have the meta editor closed, and we'll try. And still doesn't show up. So it has nothing to do with the version of the software we've created. It only has to do with the MT4 platform. And safe from closing all the windows and moving all we have on one single screen, I don't know what else I could try. So let's try to bring all in on one single screen and see if that changes anything. We'll make this disconnecting the one of the other monitors and see if that helps. Apparently it doesn't. Welcome to the Microsoft Windows world, which is neither here nor there. Let's try something a little bit different then. We'll go like this. I will try to move the code to another platform and share the screen here, and we'll see how that goes. We will kill this task and with that task killed, I will open another window which will have And this type of events can happen to anyone. Therefore, let's see how we sail through. And I will undock and connect this server, which we will use to test our software. Meantime, I will move the expert advisor we've already coded to the new platform. And this will go like this. Okay, and here we should have, let's see, on this test box, another version of the same paper plane tool, which already copied itself, and we'll put it in the experts folder of the platform we will be testing with. And now we will start the platform once that is copied. And I'm seeing that you see what is happening. If you have questions about some aspect we are trying to test or we've discussed in this webinar, please address them in the chat. Meantime, the platform should start. and we will also be able to test the code we've written together. This platform, that is my testing platform, I have currently a few tests running and I'm trying to reduce the load and make the things run a little bit smoother. For example, I will temporarily close this one and this one. And all that remains should be the platform. And finally, the platform is up. Now let's see if we can log in with a demo account. Open an account on this server, new demo. That will have some fake data here. And let's put, as we should, some reasonable numbers here, because what we are testing would also have to become true in real life. So having unrealistic expectation and unrealistic numbers in demo accounts will not help us in any way. Now let's see if in this platform we are allowed to test. The code that is already in here and should be showing us what we didn't have on the Windows 10 platform before. This, as we may already saw, is running on a Windows 2012 R2 server on a VPS in another location. And what we've done, we've moved the code from the Windows 10 machine that was locally to the VPS, and now we are trying to test it on the VPS itself. So the expert properties for the paper plane to expert advisor now look like this. And we may have a magic number, the same fixed lot entry, and as entry validation, now we have not one, but two strategies that can be either one of them true, both of them false, or none of them, or one of them active in any combination we want, and the moving average settings and the RSI settings. Okay, let's test if the expert advisor works as before with only the moving average slope, and we'll put it on a 1 hour chart. To see whether it initiates trades based on the moving average slope entry strategy, and that will begin shortly. Meantime, if you have questions, please ask them in the question section of the webinar interface. I see a few people offered suggestions, and I thank you for that. And now the test has begun. Moving closer on the chart, let's see whether the entry was valid or not. We have a moving average that is sloping upwards, and the entry, as we've seen, was here and resulted in an unprofitable trade because the market moved down and didn't reach for our target. Then we had a sell here under the moving average. Then we have another sell here because the price is under the moving average and the moving average is sloping down. But eventually we'll get closed by hitting either a take profit or the stop loss. And above the moving average, with the moving average upward slope, we have an entry here, which is a buy entry. Now, let's verify if the balance, equity, and free margin are displayed with two decimal points, as we've modified the code. And it appears that the old strategy works as before. So we have buys above the moving average sloping up, and we have sells below the moving average sloping down. Looking to switch the moving average slope, will switch to false, and we'll test for the RSI OBOS strategy. So that is the only entry validation rule now. And in the next one, we will be looking at the RSI of 20 periods, whether it is looking upwards or downwards for the past two bars, and if it is above or below the minimum and the maximum set. And as we see here, let's move a little bit closer and even closer. What do we have here? We have an entry at this precise point, because for the last two bars, let's see their values. This is the entry bar, and we are looking at this bar, bar one and bar two. So on the bar one, the RSI was 64.59.58. The previous was 62.28.35. That means this is lower than this. This is looking upwards. This is a valid buy. Now, that trade will eventually close, and this one was initiated here, and the bar one is this, bar two is this. On the bar one, we are looking here at the RSI value. So the bar one RSI value is 63.23.43 and 55.80.64. So this was bigger than this. The RSI slope is down, and we entered the cell here. That eventually get closed, and so on and so forth. It is continuing to open buys and sells depending on the RSI slope. So the second strategy we've implemented is also working. And now if both of them are false, Let's see how that works. It should result in the expert advisor not opening any trades, because no matter what happens on the charts, it will not have valid signals neither from one nor from the other strategy. And as we see, the price is down, the RSI was down and up, the price is up, the RSI was down and up, and no trades were open. Why? Because neither one of the strategies are active for this particular test. Now we are stopping the test and we are trying the last and final one, which is we will activate the first strategy and the second strategy, and with both of them true, they would have to be both true at the same time to result in a valid signal. So we will have to have both the moving average and the RSI sloping down and both looking in the same direction to have a valid entry. And as we see, let's move closer to the chart and see what is this. Is the entry candle, and this is bar one and this is bar two, and we will be looking at the values here for the RSI and for the moving average. So before the entry bar, which is here, bar one is here, bar two is here, and we have RSI 64.59, 62.28, which means going up, and now the moving average 112.085, 112.049, which is also up. So we have up slope above the moving average, and the RSI is not overbought yet. So it is a valid buy. That eventually gets closed, and here a sell with a sloping down, because we have 112.39 moving average, 112.39.1, 112.39.3, so it is going down, and the RSI is 53.23.48 and 55.80.54, so that was also going down. Invalid entry, sell. In all the cases we can imagine, all the combinations possible with only two strategies, we can have one of them active, both of them active, or none of them active. The code works as expected. So this should conclude the test I was planning to take, and we conducted to see whether our expert advisor works and what we've implemented is working as expected. And now reaching practically the final slide of the presentation, I will kindly ask you to think of any more questions I could answer to you, if it is possible. And meantime, I will try to ask for you to participate in this little poll we are trying to to gauge the interest our presentation and our subject was met with from your part, trusting that you've had enough patience and we've seen the end of the test together. I apologize for the technical difficulties we were having, and again, as before, I am available to answer the questions you might have about what we've worked in this webinar, and whether or not you intend to use this code as a starting point or something that may help you in your future developments. The code will be available in the Facebook private group we have, and I invite you to contribute there. We also would like to thank you for your continuous participation in our community and going further in the new year and the years to come. We may maybe work together on some other projects. I am open to your suggestions. You may address, send, publish them in our Facebook private group, and there you will find our support staff and whatever problems you encounter coding your own solutions or developing, starting from what we've proposed to you. We may continue to develop and work together and hone our trading skills, whether it is discretionary or algorithmic. It doesn't really matter, as long as it is tradable by a human being. It should be also tradable using automated system. This will conclude the poll. I'm closing the poll, and I'm looking at the questions you've addressed. If you have any more, please feel free to address them in the questions. And I see Rafael Morena asked, which indicators work well together and which indicators are contradictory? That may be from some 10 minutes ago, I think, when we were still trying to put together a coherent strategy that resulted in this code being implemented. Let's see which indicators work well together. Generally, indicators that tell the same story about the same thing at the same time work well together. To define that is pretty tricky, because what we see on our chart is just a small part of the market, a small fraction of the market, and not all traders look at the same charts at the same time and see the same thing. For example, here, what do we have? Here we have, let's take, this is the template we were using to test the paper plane version 2 we've just coded. And we have a 20 simple moving average on a M15 chart and an RSI with 20 periods, looking at the 20 periods back. What we see here, we are looking for indicators that work well together. We see as we've previously discussed, we've selected a moving average and an RSI because we are trying to gauge two different aspects of the market. We are trying to gauge the trend by the moving average and the momentum of the market by the RSI. They work well together. Why? Because they both tell us something about this market. The one tells us we are still in a certain type of trend, and the other one tells us we have a certain momentum. Both informations are valuable. Other types of information or convergence we may gauge or gather, taking for example not a 20 moving average but a 100 moving average, and plotting a 100 moving average over a 20 moving average, we have two indicators, and all that's different about them is the period that is taken into consideration when their values are calculated. Both of the indicators are trend indicators. Changing only the period, they tell us practically the same story about the same market, but at different time scales. This one is a 20, this one is a 100, these times. This means that one is 5 times less speedy, let's say, less responsive, because it will take longer for this one to become from an up sloping moving average, down sloping moving average. And as we see, if the 20 moving average is responsive enough, the move started here, and by the time the moving average is sloping up, we've only wasted 5-7 periods, candles, 10 candles, let's say. Now, from the time this move starts, this moving average is still sloping down, and about here is starting to move up. So that being 100 makes the response time more laggy, and it will take longer for it to become useful for us. It will put us in trades later, and laggy by definition, it is even more laggier the longer the period is. Let's drag another indicator on the chart. This time, let's try to leave it with the default values. What do we see here? An RSI of 14 and a momentum of an RSI of 20 and a momentum of 14 are showing us different information about the same market. We see here that an up move in the market that resulted in a momentary overbought condition on the RSI is practically showing as a continuously moving up and the strengthening of momentum to the upside and up until this point when the momentum is on the downside. And from this point, it is on the downside also. The momentum indicator doesn't have an overbought and oversold area. It only has, for example, this 100 level center line, and it is considered a downward momentum market, one in which the indicator is consistently showing momentum going in one direction above or below that 100 level. So in this market, for example, if we were to believe the RSI, we are looking for diminishing strength or increasing strength to the downside, and we are looking at the momentum indicator, which is showing us from this point on the same thing. Practically both of them are looking more bearish at up, down and down, up until the market gets eventually a moment of rest retraces, and then the move continues. Here we see the same thing, the RSI going down until it eventually becomes oversold. The momentum is going down, and down it goes until the market reaches the current price, the current. Let's look at another market. This one, EURUSD on H1, on M15 also. What do we see? If we are looking to filter the signals by the moving average, the shorter moving average is more dynamic. The longer period moving average is less dynamic. It's more laggy, is less adaptive, but it keeps us on the right side of the trade longer. For example, if you are looking for buys in this area above the 100 moving average, from this point to present day, we are only looking for the RSI to look up and not get overbought, because when it gets overbought, we are at least stop buying it. What other market participants do doesn't concern us. We remain faithful to our strategy, and if our strategy says an overbought market, we don't buy, then we don't buy an overbought market. That doesn't necessarily mean we have to sell it. Those who sold this overbought market had a certain limited success, but the strength in the market, the dominant strength in the market, is on the upside. It's still on the upside, and will remain so until our qualification criteria, which in this case is a 100 moving average, will say it isn't so anymore. So we are still looking to buy this. When we are looking to buy, every time the RSI moves to the upside, and as long as it doesn't go again overbought, like here or here. Do we have the same information about the same market at the same time using the other indicator? It is a momentum indicator. It also tells us that if it is above 100, we're looking to buy as long as it is moving up. If it is moving down, we don't want to buy this. We don't want to sell this. Why? Because we are still above the equilibrium point, which in this case is 100 level. It is looking up, it is above 100, we buy this, and this, and this, and this, and this one, and this, until it gets eventually overbought here. Maybe this. And we are not changing our medium or long-term bias based on a very short period trend indicator, like a short moving average is. And that may result in some good trades. Christian Jepsen, I'm sorry for the pronunciation. Christian Jepsen asked, paper plane available for download? Yes, it will be published in the Facebook private group, and I'll make a post about it. And the webinar recording will be available on the forexbot.com website in the section dedicated to the webinars. I believe it is forexbot.com/webinars. It will be uploaded, and it will be available there to watch, to our to be available for our members there to watch. Any more questions? If you have, I I'm saying it's okay, thanks, thank you, but no more questions. So, if there is anything else we should talk about, please ask a question now or forever hold your peace or until you make a post in our private Facebook group or on our website in the forum, because forexboat.com has also a forum. And I invite you to contribute in both communities because we are practically the same community. Okay, then no more questions. I won't take any more of your time. I thank you again to all of you that attended and wishing you a very good start of the new year and much success in whatever your main activity is, trading included. I'm wishing and I'm leaving you with good trades and good pips. Have a nice day, evening, and see you along. Thank you and goodbye.